What's up, Saints?
That's right.
I am back.
What it do, baby? Welcome to my 100 subscriber special. By the way, I really appreciate y'all. It means so much to me. I am truly blessed. I'm so glad God has given me this opportunity. So for my 100 subscriber special, I thought it'd be a good idea to review my first sermon. For some reason. But believe me, there is a method behind the madness, okay? I thought this would be a perfect example to showcase how God can use someone who has no clue what they're doing. You know, me watching my sermon really reminds me of like the conversation Moses had with God when he was talking to him about like how he struggles to talk in Exodus 4:10. Yeah, like that. And yet Moses is considered to be one of the greatest leaders in all of history, all because he had faith in God. And see, this is exactly what I believe happened to me in this sermon. I was so lacking in experience that I was just like, is shaking. I was out here like Paul in the church of Corinth in 1 Corinthians 2. And you wanna know what the funny part about all of this is? People after the sermon I preached were coming up and congratulating me. And at first I thought they were being nice, but many came to me and said how I impacted their lives. And I was like, what? I could tell a lot of them were being legitimately genuine. And I was over here like,
What are you talking about?
Now, I know what you're probably thinking. Oh, Jordan, you probably didn't do that bad. It was your first sermon. You're just being humbled. No.
Yeah.
No, bro. This is objectively bad. And yet, God still used me. Before we get started, let me give you some context of what's happening. This was my sophomore year of high school. I went to an Adventist boarding academy in Georgia called GCA, and I was approached by one of the faculty or student, I can't remember, that asked me if I wanted to do the week of prayer, a student week of prayer. And at first I was like, I'm humbled. I'm so glad. You know what? Don't even worry about it. I gotcha. You know, funny enough, the topic of the student week of prayer was putting the full armor of God. They get it, they get it. And so each day a student did a different piece of the armor in the week. I was lucky enough to get the last one, the sword of the spirit, on Saturday. I know, right? Spice.
Outside the court and inside the-
So without further ado, let's get into this. Are y'all ready to cringe? 'Cause I'm not.
I also can't guarantee that I'm gonna watch all of this.
It's time to engage the enemy.
Oh yeah, I remember this. So this guy was like a soldier describing like a war uniform and like relating that to the armor of God. It was actually pretty cool.
Ah! Like that! Thank you.
Is that an M4? I can't tell, but it was supposed to represent the sword of the spirit. Pretty cool, I like it. And he was also introducing me before I came out.
I'd like to introduce Jordan, who will discuss your battlefield spiritual warfare weapon.
Oh, here I go. Oh boy, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Hello? Hello? Y'all hear me? God is good. Morning, happy Sabbath, church. My name is Jordan Williams. This past week's week of prayer, our theme for this week.
Look how nervous I am. Oh man, yo, I'm so nervous. Oh my goodness. Bro, I was so nervous. I was just gonna ask the pastor like to tag in for me. Like I really couldn't handle the pressure. It was so much. I was doing this in front of all my friends. It was ridiculous. I never had so much anxiety in my life. I was sweating. Also, I wrote out word for word what I'm going to say in the sermon. I know that's kind of unorthodox for a lot of preachers, but there's a couple I know who do it. That's what helps me. And I still do that to this day.
To this day!
He indeed mentions in the preceding verses that we are in spiritual battle against a principality, authority, and a power that's unseen.
Hey, I like that.
You have been bought with the price. Literally, there is no way out for you. You are doomed in every sense of the word. But in Ephesians, the Apostle Paul tells us to take...
Easy on the pronunciation. You're doing a good job so far.
The only thing that can protect us...
Check your My mic was jacked up and I didn't even notice. So sad. Can't be helped though. Yeah. Let's go.
Paul tells us to receive a breastplate.
Oof. Take it easy, Chief. You got it.
A never-ending gospel that gives us the knowledge to, instead of hate your enemy, love thine enemy as thyself.
Why do I keep doing that? I keep like moving my hands and it's like I'm being jittery or something. And I'm sweating profusely and stumbling all over my words. And I'm talking so fast. Man, I hate this.
A shield, which gives you upholding faith in God's plan for you.
Oh, also, this is also kind of minor, but my pants, if you can see right here, are terrible. And I know judging clothing isn't a big thing, and it shouldn't be a big thing, but my case was a little bit different because I chose to dress the way I dressed. I actually transformed my church pants into joggers. I don't think y'all heard me. I turned my church pants into joggers. They look awful, but at the end of the day, it's clothing. It's not that deep.
Believe in him. Believe in his word, and he will always come through for you in the end. Let's pray. Father.
Oh, the prayer. Now, look, when we pray to God, we should always come genuinely to him. Always. That's all he wants of us. But this is not what I was doing. No. No, no, no. Now, what did I do? I took a prayer online, and I just read it out. Now, in essence, there's nothing inherently wrong with that as long as it's genuine, but I was just doing it all for show, and that's, you know, that's a huge thing. I think people get caught up in kind of like the show when they're on the pulpit, no matter what they're doing, if they're singing, if they're preaching, and it's a really bad habit that I really try not to replicate anymore. So yeah, don't do what I did.
Please open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11.
Oh, bro, I was so happy when people started opening the Bibles. I'm like, yes, a break. I can chill out. I can gather my thoughts. I can just relax. I'm just taking my sweet time, man.
I mean, because he was fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. I mean, us as GCA students, I mean, we could barely survive an hour without some food. Like, I mean, come on, son.
Relatable humor for the win, baby!
You know those type of people who try to insult you, but they try so hard when they say it, it's just foolishness flying from their mouth? Amen? That's exactly what Satan's doing. It's so dumb.
Oh, yeah. Words of affirmation. That and physical touch are my top two love languages. I was so discouraged, I had to get a forced amen from the audience.
Amen?
I was like, amen? Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Right? Ah, oh, so bad. So cringe.
And we walk over there to our problems in front of Satan. We're like, all right, Satan, die. Satan, stop. Those are real bullets, Satan. And Satan's like, well, you don't say. I'm shooting you. and then we go running back to God. God, man, this is foolish. Satan was everywhere. He was firing real bullets, God, real bullets.
Nah, don't look at me. I don't know what's happening.
What I mean by that is when I progress reading the Bible, especially from a young age, I see things in Scripture and the words don't change, but the way my mind receives it differently changes.
Bro, relax.
But like any other thing, you have to maintain it daily. Just like if you're weightlifting. I mean, you can't weightlift for only 2 days and expect to get strong. No, you gotta keep doing it. You gotta keep pumping. And it's tiring and annoying when people say, hey, read your Bible. Yo, read your Bible. Hey, read your Bible. Read your Bible.
We get it.
All your struggles in your life will be gone and you will feel like a new human being.
Side note, don't believe what I just said there. That was theologically incorrect. Stating that if you believe in God and all your struggles will just be gone like in an instant is not entirely true. You know, as Christians, we face struggles all the time, and that doesn't, you know, guarantee us physical safety from our struggles. You know, putting it to God, whatever his will might be, is what you should trust in. And it goes back to like my Hero Academia video where I talk about Romans 5, 3 through 5 and, you know, us taking joy in our sufferings and learning from them and growing from them. You know, even Jesus suffered a lot. It's just part of being a Christian. It's part of being a human. So like just saying like all of them will just poof vanish, just not realistic. But just for clarification, I just felt like that needed to be clarified.
There was a man and a son. They were riding in a car, and this is way before air conditioning. And, yeah, no, hard to believe. The breastplate, which contains the righteousness of the Son of Man, righteousness that gives you the opportunity and the ability to be in a different category than the wickedness from the earth and from the world.
Oh, yeah. So this is where one of my old friends actually puts on the armor while I'm saying it. It wasn't too bad. And then my favorite part comes up. This is the best part.
My friends, then and only then will we be able to stand with this armor.
Anything, bro. Classic. So good. Mwah, masterpiece. And then I come back and say a prayer that I found online without even pretending to close my eyes. All of this, man. All of these mistakes. And God still used the Holy Spirit to convince people. He used it to inspire them. God is something else. So, that was it. Let me know how you felt about the sermon. I'll leave the link down in the bio if you want to want to do full-on cringe, but I'm actually curious, you know, what did y'all think about the sermon? Was it as cringe as I said? Or nah, you don't think so. I think it's horrible. And in reverence to the way I ended my sermon, I'll end with this.